اروپا میگوید بر سر توافق هسته‌ای با ایران با امریکا همصدا نمی‌شود و همچنان به آن توافق پایبند است. ولی تا کی می‌تواند در مقابل فشارهای امریکا و تحریم‌های شدید آن علیه ایران مقاومت کند؟ موضع بریتانیا به خصوص بعد از نهایی شدن خروج آن از اتحادیه اروپا در مقابل این توافقنامه و به طور کلی در مقابل ایران چه می‌تواند باشد؟ لورد دیوید اوئن مهمان من در این برنامه سیاستمدار قدیمی و برجسته بریتانیا است که در زمان انقلاب ایران وزیر خارجه بریتانیا بود و حالا به عنوان عضو مجلس اعیان همچنان سیاستمداری است با نفوذ. او اخیراً در کتابی زیر عنوان سیاست خارجی بریتانیا بعد از خروج از اتحادیه اروپا به بسیار از این مسائل پرداخته است. نظر او درباره سیاست بریتانیا در خصوص ایران زیر تحریم شدید امریکا چیست و آیا بریتانیا می تواند و می خواهد به توافق هسته‌ای با ایران پایبند بماند؟ Lord Owen, David Owen, welcome to the program.
Very nice to be here.
Thank you. You have allocated a chapter in your book to Middle East, and well, the title of your book obviously is the British Foreign Policy After the Brexit, to Middle East, and also a section to Iran and specifically to the nuclear agreement with 5+1. Did you expect President Trump to actually withdraw from the agreement?
I think I did. I followed pretty carefully President Trump's rise in American politics, and one of his interesting characteristics is that if he makes a commitment, he seems more bound than most politicians to actually carrying it out. And it was very clear in the rhetoric of his campaign that he was not going to accept this agreement.
Mm-hmm. Indeed, you actually you were not very very optimistic. You said it in your book that no one expects the Trump administration to embrace the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, but the U.S. will not find it easy to unilaterally renegotiate the plan. But while looking at it from what the Foreign Secretary of America, Mike Pompeo, put forward a 12 demands, very harsh demands. Mm-hmm. It's many people think that these demands amounts to regime change, basically. My question is that the is President Trump want does President Trump want to negotiate?
I think he does, and I think it's best to accept when he says he doesn't want regime change. That probably is his own personal position. Around him in his administration, there will be many people who will want regime change, and many people in America. But, you know, regime change now has been adopted by three presidents, and I think most people in America begin to think it doesn't work, and that you topple a leader, take Libya and Gaddafi, and think of the situation. We tried to get away without putting troops on the ground, and that has failed. We put troops on the ground in Iraq and Afghanistan, and that has failed. I think there is more and more a recognition that these interventions militarily into these countries can be counterproductive.
But do you think that people like John Bolton or Giuliani, who have been promoting regime change here, are convinced that this is not going to work?
I don't think it matters. I think as long as President Trump is there, he will make foreign policy. And John Bolton can have his views. I remember John Bolton made a linkage between North Korea and Libya, and Trump disowned it straight away. And he didn't take Bolton with him to Singapore, and he put Pompeo to be doing the negotiations in North Korea. I think it's very difficult with this administration to get yourself online of a different one to Trump without finding yourself having your influence reduced. I think Bolton shares a lot of Trump's views. I think he's actually a good appointment. I've never wanted to see either the security advisor in the White House or even the Secretary of State far removed from the president. It makes for huge confusion. And I think particularly with Trump, it's pretty important to have people around him who broadly share his views, but they won't all agree with it, all that he says, thank goodness.
Do you think that Europe tried hard enough to convince him not to withdraw from the agreement?
Yes, I think they did. I think that our Prime Minister, when she went over there, on the first to see him, made it very clear even then. And then I think that President Macron did everything he could. He did a rather effective wooing on his visit to Paris. You know, it was rather successful in terms of human contact. But in terms of content, I don't think it was ever going to sway him. He was quite determined not to do it. He tends to not like doing anything that Obama did, and probably almost all his predecessors. And he's quite open about this. He has not come to Washington as part of continuity of foreign policy. So this, in a way, is Iran's chance. This is a man who doesn't carry in his baggage. He's got a lot of baggage, but he doesn't carry in his baggage any real involvement with the various policies between America and Iran that have caused so much bad faith and bad feelings over the last 30 or 40 years.
Yeah. What? How do you see the roles of the Saudi Arabia and Israel in actually pushing Trump into some sort of aggression against Iran?
Well, I think that is the biggest worry. Sunni Shia divide in the Middle East. And on this, I am adamant Britain should have nothing to do with it. We will not polarize that divide, which is bad enough anyhow, without getting ourselves lined up on one side of it. We won't do that. And I don't think there's any doubt about that. I think Trump is open, and I don't think he's probably ever really focused on Iran. The fact that he is going to chair this meeting of the Security Council means even he'll have to read a few papers to get himself somewhat in touch with it. And I think as he gets in touch with it, there's a chance that he'll get gripped by it. And if he gets gripped by it, then it becomes a deal. And then it becomes a deal, and then he thinks about it a lot. And he has views on deals, and he thinks he's a great deal maker. Mm-hmm. And maybe he is. You know, he can't go on scoffing at everything. I mean, if I'd been interviewing you now about Mexico, and you told me that he would end up with a bilateral agreement on NAFTA with the outgoing Mexican president, I'd have said, you must be joking. And now then to use that agreement to leverage Canada to accept a NAFTA arrangement, which they're having a lot of difficulty with. So this is not a fool. It would be a great mistake to underestimate his, once he's engaged, getting him engaged is serious, then I think he becomes serious, and then his negotiating skills, he prides himself greatly, and maybe we shouldn't rate them too low either.
Well, he hasn't ruled out meeting the Iranian leaders and talking to them.
I mean, If President Rouhani wants to meet, he'll definitely meet him.
Yeah.
And I'm sure President Rouhani is not going to take my advice, but I would do so. Mm-hmm. I see human contact matters to him. That's how he does business, mm-hmm. on the telephone or in direct conversation. And broadly speaking, there's nobody else there. He doesn't come in with a mass of aides. He doesn't come in with a road of briefing papers. He comes in with ideas and prejudices and all sorts of problems. But his first issue is, does he feel engaged with you? Is he, not necessarily meaning he likes you, but even, it's important, of course, if he does like you, because I think he becomes much more amenable. But I think, you know, he is what we are, what we have. Mm-hmm. I mean, spending your whole time arguing about whether or not he should be president or not is irrelevant. Mm-hmm. He is the president of the United States. Therefore, he is an important figure. And we must work with him, but not exclusively. And I'm very pleased that the EU has held firm and that the Chinese and the Russians as well. And I think this is why I've always wanted to use the five permanent members of the Security Council I think it's about the only thing we've got left. The Security Council itself has been virtually ineffective, and it is still possible to put that grouping of five, and in the case of your agreement over nuclear weapons, Germany has played an important role, so try and involve Germany. But I think the days of the EU having a separate position are probably getting less and less. Mm-hmm. They try and get it, but I think Trump doesn't like these multilateral negotiations. Mm-hmm. He prefers one-on-one.
Yeah, well, I mean, you say that you're happy that the Europe stood firm on this, and I actually, you recommend it in your book as well, that they should stand by the agreement.
Yes, I mean, I'm in favor of Britain leaving the European Union, and I'm in favor of restoring and having an independent British foreign policy. Mm-hmm. But even when we're out, we will still work with, firstly, France, because he's a permanent member of the Security Council, secondly, Germany, because it's the most powerful country in Europe, and is a good friend, and well, I have no intention of giving up my European connections and friendships and things. I just don't want my foreign policy to be absorbed in a melange, mm-hmm. soft pudding of 27 countries. I don't believe you can conduct a foreign policy on the basis of 27 countries. So I don't think the EU has been the significant player in the negotiations of the six. Both of the two EU foreign ministers, in quote, have played a useful role in the overall history of it. And remember, these negotiations started off just Europe and Iran, and I think the more that it's had it China and Russia, the better.
But despite all this, the agreement is in jeopardy at the moment. I mean,
yes,
long do you think that Europe and Britain, for that matter, can resist the pressure from America and stay by the agreement?
Well, I'm a little apprehensive about this Security Council meeting, in the sense that it's right in the eyes of the world, and will it just be for public relations terms? But it's taking place, and as I say, I'm in favor of engaging the president with Iranian problems, and therefore I'm also very much in favor of a dialogue between President Putin and President Trump. I think the two men have to get together to get a resolution in the Middle East. And I think, therefore, I would put the nuclear question all the time in the background of negotiations within the Middle East. So you keep it there, and I think we have that power. I think China and Russia and France and Britain can ensure that it's part of a Middle East dialogue in the background. And then as you make progress on the Middle East settlement, it becomes easier for all sides to make adjustments to their position. And it makes it easier for Iran to come to a peaceful relationship with their neighbors in the Middle East. That's all really, if you look at it, is what America's asking for.
Yeah.
Unless you believe they're trying to topple the regime.
Yeah.
You see, I approach the Iranian government with this really view, that you will never in Iran, well, certainly on my lifetime, and probably never totally remove the church from the state. That is has reached a fixed point probably now. So going back to a religion that takes no role in the state, but diminishing the role of the religion in the state, and I think becomes extremely important and almost certain outcome. So the question is at what speed it happens. It's totally inappropriate in a modern world for a religion to be a negotiator on behalf of a country. And so the Ayatollahs and the overall the church must be ready to slowly and steadily pull back. And I think that will make it much easier to have a dialogue. But the fundamental problem is, when will the military in Iran, having achieved so much power and a taste for power, and also some of the riches that come with power, who's going to tame them, who's going to pull them back into a constitutional role within a political structure. Well, that can only be done by the Ayatollah. So he has to, as he moves, and I think he will, mm-hmm. or his successors will, the relationship with the military will become very important. The military will become too strong in Iran.
Yes. And I'm sure you've been following the situation in Iran. And now, after the reimposing all these sanctions by the Americans against Iran, and also withdrawing from the nuclear agreement, so far the only outcome has been that the President Rouhani, who was regarded as a moderate and wants a good relations with the West and other mm-hmm. countries, has been pushed back into the position of the extremists or conservatives.
Maybe. You know, I'm old enough to have watched the criminology. In the old days of the Soviet Union, everybody studied exactly who was seeing who in the Kremlin. You didn't really know, you guessed, experts and things like that. I don't think we know, really, the relationship within the, say, top 10 influences in Iran. But I think that Iran is having to adjust. The revolution took a long time to settle, and it took a long time because of the Iran-Iraq war and the disgraceful position in which all of us took over it. And this was an outright invasion from Iraq, and we should have been much blunter and clearer about our position, and I said so at the time too. So I think my relations with Iran, of course, have been up and down. I was seen as a great villain because I stood by the Shah, but in standing by the Shah, I was standing by what was the Iranian government, mm-hmm. government-to-government relations. It's exactly the same my attitude to Trump. I don't have to approve or disapprove, but I have to work with him. My country has to work closely with whoever's president of the United States. So I have no doubt and have been quite open. I'm ready to discuss and have been for the last 30 years with any Iranian who wants to talk. I'm mm-hmm. completely open. It's a great country. We have to reach an accommodation, and the sooner the better.
Mm-hmm. And obviously you recommend that the Iran and America at some stage they should talk.
Not only should they talk, yeah. But America must recognize that these were long and complicated negotiations, and just as we recognize President Trump, so we recognize previous presidents. We yeah. work with them too. So he can't go on with this business that he can just disown everything that has happened before. That in doing that, he is disowning our relationship as well. So this has to be occasionally met by steel. So every now and then, when he pushes too far, we have to have a firm and principled position. And as far as so far on the nuclear question, we do have a firm and principled position. But where we disagree with you is we do not think it is unreasonable to, when you have a negotiation and you sign up to an agreement, to start to look at other parts of your relationship. And if they're going wrong, then it affects us. So Iran playing a military role in Syria, Iran playing around in Lebanon and on the issue of Israel is not an acceptable position. That's as simple as that. Mm-hmm. It will not get peace in the Middle East. Now, Iran can say, we are entitled to choose to support Syria. We're entitled to choose to support the Lebanese government. After all, there are a lot of Shia people living in Lebanon. Absolutely right. But not with a military presence. Mm-hmm. And that's where we're all going to have to come to some accommodation. But it's in that wider context. And I'm very pleased to see slowly the Middle East now. Nobody talks about a Middle East negotiation in which both Iran and Israel are present. And to have neither of those states, or to yeah. have only one, means you're not going to get a solution. And President Putin deserves a lot of praise for that. He is one leader who has consistently seen all sides. I mean, he's seen Netanyahu as often as he's seen any other leader in the Middle East. And he's given the Israeli president a role, not because he necessarily agrees with it. So I think that also the relationship between Saudi and Israel is a helpful one. doesn't mean it's altogether all good for Iran or for the Palestinians or the other thing, but there is a dialogue, and quite an advanced dialogue, between Saudi Arabia, Egypt, and the United States.
But the because their common enemy, apparently, is Iran, that's why. I mean, this is over Iran that they are.
Yeah, I agree with that. I think that's been the cement that has held it together. Mm-hmm. And our job in Britain, who wants to have good relations with all, is to try to make sure that that relationship can be cemented together by concrete progress in lots of other different fields. And so come back to it. We are not prepared to see a Sunni-Shia war. Absolutely flat out, we're not going to, and we will not take sides in such a war.
I mean, you actually very strongly in your book say that the British government shouldn't take side on this. Oh. But do you see any sign that they might do that you're warning?
No, I don't think we will. Mm-hmm. I don't think we will. I think that, we've been irritated by President Trump's stance on this, but we understand its motivation. And we think he is correct in a lot of his views about Iranian intervention. Now, you must remember that from the moment that Putin accepted the request from Assad to come in militarily, and that was in 2015, when it looked very, very seriously as if Damascus would fall, they have become a player. Obama should have said at that time, we quite understand why you're going to save Damascus. It makes it much easier to get an eventual peace to ensure that no irrational force gets... And ISIS was in the suburbs, in fact, only recently has gone from the suburbs of Damascus. But Obama should have said, but we reserve the right to defend Aleppo and make sure that Aleppo is not overrun. And that would mean... Some people would have said it partition, but it would have been to establish two influences in a country that desperately needs help, not just from one side. Anyhow, that wasn't done, but we cooperated very well over ISIS, and the military on the telephone to each other, and that has included some relationships, mainly through Syria, as to what's happening to Iran forces. Yeah. So cooperation over ISIS, which has been successful, in Syria, but where is ISIS? ISIS is in Sinai, ISIS is in Libya, ISIS is in many of these alternate conflicts. There is also in Afghanistan.
Yes, absolutely.
Now, Afghanistan is interesting because that's an area where Iran has been very helpful at various times, and America has never recognized this enough. Mm-hmm. And one moment there was a rather helpful point soon after 9/11 when Iran could have been and was offering to be helpful over Afghanistan, and America didn't want to take it up, and that was a mistake of Bush. Mm.
Coming back to the agreement, the nuclear agreement, do you think that Britain, after the Brexit, would be able to stand by its agreement on nuclear issue in Iran? Considering that probably after Brexit the American become very prominent economically for Britain to rely on?
I'm not altogether sure of that premise. I mean, I think America is pretty important in Britain anyhow, and has been for a very long time, and people ignore that. And they think that our only relationship is with Europe. That's never been the case. I'm a Brexiteer because I wish to keep a British foreign policy. I remember talking to Henry Kissinger about this. He didn't join the American academics and foreign policy establishment who all signed letters that there should be no Brexit and that Britain should stay in Europe. He wanted a British voice in foreign policy. I mean, he's going to have that British voice. And we're not always right. But I think it's overall been a sound and good voice in international politics throughout my lifetime. I can't judge it really much before that. We've made our mistakes, but not many. And there's never been a British government that wants regime change in Iran. We would have, even when I was there, I knew that the Shah, as the all-powerful leader, would not last, and that there had to be a transition.
on occasion about the military action against Iran.
Well, Tony Blair, in my views, foreign policy ideas are completely dangerous, ill thought through, and absurd. This man has gone out of his way to put him, champion himself on bombing Iran at the time when Israel was vehemently demanding it. He was one of the very few Western voices in favor of it. Now, that was madness. When will he learn? He made some very grave mistakes over Afghanistan and particularly Iraq, and he goes on thinking he's in power. But actually, take Brexit. We, most of us, long for him to make a speech about Brexit because it increases support for Brexit. It's a bit like Obama's visit, actually. Obama's visit to, in the middle of the referendum campaign, ensured the only spike in the opinion polls. They went up 3 to 5% in favor of Brexit. People don't like interfering in other people's policies as far as possible, and international affairs has to give a great deal of weight to what the government of the day is saying. We don't choose that government, whether or not they're elected or not. And we must try to be modest about it. And when it became clear that the revolution was going to happen, I accepted it, but I predicted it would be very traumatic in terms of both human rights and in terms of stability, and it has been both. So, but now we are in a situation where Iran overcame the danger to its boundaries and borders from Iraq. Saddam Hussein is no longer there. You have a Shia prime minister in Baghdad. So you can't tell me that you're under threat any longer. Why do you want to have this great military endeavor in Syria or Lebanon? That is because you want to fight Israel, or at least some of your military commanders and a few of your religious leaders. You're going to have to learn a measure of tolerance about Israel. But Israel's also got to learn a measure of tolerance about all the other countries in the Middle East.
Exactly. You talk about Israel, you've got only 1 minute, and I have to ask you this question because you allocated a big chapter of your book to the Middle East. Do you see any prospect of the two-state solution, considering that nobody's talking about it anymore, many people think it's dead?
I think it appears that America, Saudi Arabia, and Egypt want to keep a two-state solution. If it doesn't succeed under them, it'll completely end, in my view. I think there are merits in it, but I don't think it's acceptable to the Israelis to have a one state, because I don't think they're prepared to honor the obligation of treating all their citizens equally. And so you get an apartheid state. I don't believe that Israel currently is an apartheid solution or situation, but I think that a one state solution would have to mean an Israeli government that is absolutely prepared to give equal rights to Arab and Israelis in one country. And I don't think, well, certainly Netanyahu is not ready to do it. So a one-state solution would come, if it was ever going to come, more from the left than the right. And at the moment, the left in Israel still wants a two-state solution.
Yeah.
So I think stick with a two-state solution. But, you know, again, Trump's negotiated sensibly in a way. People are very angry about him accepting his capital in Jerusalem. Every single one of the presidents, Obama, Clinton, Bush, all told the electorate twice when they were standing that they were going to put an American embassy in Jerusalem.
He's done it.
And he's done it and cleared the ground. He was never going to negotiate it.
Okay.
So it's much easier to have a negotiation now that this has been done. Unfortunately, it's had some very bad effects and people have lost their lives and everything like that. But it ought to encourage a more equal negotiation now that that issue is resolved, then they're going to have an American embassy and more embassies go to Jerusalem.
Do you agree with those who say that if the Palestine-Israel problem is solved, lots of other problems in the Middle East will be solved, including the presence of Iran in the area and the animosity between Iran and Israel?
Exactly, and that's why I believe we have to have a Middle East settlement, and I think this nuclear question will not be resolved, but it must be there as an element in an eventual settlement, and it may be only in an eventual settlement that Trump will live with it and accept it. And I think that's what we have to work for. Everything is on the table. All the parties in the Middle East are around the table. And the fundamental elements of coming together has got to be between Putin and Trump. And Putin has put himself into a powerful position. As I say, Assad may not always take account of what he's saying, but he'll have to listen.
Lord Owen, thank you very much.
Pleasure.
Thank you for being my guest.
Enjoyed it very much.
Thank you.